Okay, so this is our second video covering material from section 3.2 for Math 15 60 Calculus 1 at U of L for fall 2017. In this video, we're going to look at the mean value theorem. So the mean value theorem is a generalization of Rolle's theorem, or if you like, you can think of Rolle's theorem as a special case of the mean value theorem. So again, we'll kind of look at some of the ingredients before stating the theorem. The mean value theorem has to do with the interaction between average and instantaneous rates of change. Okay? So we know that if we have a function defined on some closed interval, we can talk about the average change or the average rate of change of the function over that interval. We just take the change in y over the change in x, right, over that interval. That gives us the average change. And we know from our discussion of how we define the derivative that, you know, if we took the limit over smaller and smaller and smaller intervals, this gets us closer to this idea of the instantaneous rate of change, which is this idea of, you know, can we kind of talk about what is the rate of change at a single point or a single moment in time, right? Think of, again, velocity is a good example. You can think about your average speed over a trip, right? Distance traveled divided by the time it took you to get from point A to point B, versus your instantaneous speed, that speed on the speedometer at any moment in time as you're driving along. And the mean value theorem gives the conditions under which you can be assured that there has to be some point on your trip where your instantaneous speed has to match your average speed. And you know, driving generally meets these conditions. It's essentially continuity and differentiability, right? You don't want discontinuities in your position. That's probably a very bad thing for you physically. And so the mean value theorem basically tells you that, yes, you're guaranteed that at some point your instantaneous change has to match your average change. And the way we kind of state this exactly is as follows. If you have a continuous function on a closed interval, which is also differentiable on the corresponding open interval, then there has to be some point in between A and B, some number C, such that the instantaneous change, right, so this is my instantaneous change, has to equal the average. Okay, that's what the mean value theorem says. And if you're wondering, well, how do you actually kind of come up with this? How do you show that the mean value theorem is true? The mean value theorem is essentially Rolle's theorem turned at an angle, right? So the difference here between the mean value theorem and Rolle's theorem is we don't require that f of a equals f of b. In fact, notice that one thing you might note is that if f of a equals f of b, well, then the numerator on the right-hand side is zero, and so we're back to Rolle's theorem. Okay, now, so what the way to kind of think about this is, okay, you got your starting points, so let's say down here, a f of a, we end over here, b f of b, and so the average change, well, we know what the average change looks like. The average change is just what you get if you traveled along this straight line at constant speed, right, or a constant rate of change. You get your rise over run, you get your, right, here we get the, you know, delta y, delta x, and we can work that out. But maybe the actual function is not a, you know, a linear function like this. Maybe the actual function kind of goes along like that. Well, what do you have then? Well, what you have then is you can notice that there will be a couple of points along the way where if we were to find the tangent line at those points, we would find that the tangent line had the same slope as this line going directly from our initial point to our final point, right? So they're parallel lines, they have the same slope. And the way you actually deal with this is you say, well, you know what, that really means, you know, if we think about what is this here, well, this is a straight line. That's also the graph of a function. What is it? Well, it's a graph whose slope is f of b minus f of a over b minus a, and we begin there, and so we actually work out what the equation of that line is, and we get something that looks like, well, so when x is equal to a, we should be at f of a, right? So there's g of x. Looks like that. So one of the things that we could do is, one of the ways to show that our original function f of x has a derivative equal to g of x at some point is just to show that the difference between f of x and g of x has to have derivative zero at some point. But we know a theorem that we can use to show that there's a derivative zero. So what we can do is we can consider this function, h of x equals f of x minus g of x. And we can see that h of x is continuous. It is differentiable because f was continuous and differentiable. G of x is a linear function, so definitely continuous and differentiable. Notice that h of a equals f of a minus g of a. But if you plug x equals a into g of a, what do you get? You get f of a. And h of b, you get f of b minus g of b. But what happens if I put a b in for my x here? Well, I get a b minus a, cancels with this b minus a, and then I've got f of b minus f of a plus f of a. Well, the f of a's cancel, and I get f of b. So I get f of b minus f of b. I get zero, right? So h of a equals h of b, right? These are the same. H is differentiable, it's continuous, and it has the same value at other endpoints. So Rolle's theorem applies. And so we know that there has to be some number c where h prime of c equals zero. But we can also calculate h prime of c using derivative rules, and we get that it's f prime of c minus, well, what's g prime? We just simply, we calculate using, derivative rules, power rule, sum rule, constant rule, and we get this for the derivative of g. And so that difference is equal to zero. Moving f of c over, we get the result that we want. So that's how you can see that the mean value theorem is true, if you care to see why it's true. What can you do with the mean value theorem? Well, here's a simple example. Let's show. So one of the things we know, right? We know that the derivative of a constant function is zero. And you might wonder, is the reverse true? Is the converse true? If I know that the derivative is zero, does that guarantee that my function is a constant? Surprisingly enough, up till now, we had no way of establishing this fact, but with the mean value theorem, we can. So the way we do this is as follows. We choose any two points. Let's say x1 less, and I want x1 to be less than x2, where x1 and x2 are both in this interval from A to B. And now f prime is equal to zero. So definitely we know that f is differentiable. On this interval from x1 to x2. But we also know that differentiability implies continuity, and since x1 and x2 are inside this bigger interval where f prime is zero, we also know that f is continuous on the corresponding closed interval. So you can work that out. So you have the conditions of the mean value theorem are satisfied, and therefore we know that Well, f of x2 minus f of x1 over x2 minus x1 has to equal f prime of c for some c between x1 and x2. But what do we know about f prime of c? Has to be 0. And well, that means if I multiply both sides by x2 minus x1, that f of x2 minus f of x1 equals 0. So f of x1 has to equal f of x2, right? And so how do we finish off the argument here? Well, the basic idea is we've shown that our function has the same value at two points, but we chose these two points, they're completely arbitrary, right? We said nothing about which two points they were. And so what this really says is you choose any two points in that interval and the function is going to have the same value at both points. Well, the only way that you can guarantee that your function has the exact same value at any two points is if your function is constant. And that completes that argument. Just finish off with one quick one. Let's kind of verify that the mean value theorem works in a concrete example. Let's actually find this number c. Okay. So it's a polynomial, so we know our function is continuous and differentiable. What's f prime of x? Well, we get 3x squared minus 4, right? So we get root 3x minus 2 times root 3x plus 2. And so, oh, sorry. You know what? Never mind. I'm doing this wrong. You guys can stop watching if you want, but let's clean this up. What am I doing? Okay. I don't need to factor this. This is not necessary. What am I trying to do? I'm not trying to find where the derivative is 0. I want to show that I can get this to equal the average value. So what's f of 0? And f of 0 is 0. F of 3 is 3 cubed, 27, minus 4 times 3 minus 12 is 15. So f of 3 minus f of 0, or 3 minus 0 is 15 over 3, equals 5. And I want that to be equal to f prime of c, which is 3c squared minus 4. And so that tells me that 3c squared, add 4 to both sides, should be 9. C squared should be 3. So c should be plus, or c squared is 9. It's the end of the day. I erased the wrong thing. So c should be plus or minus 3. And, oh. Interesting. Oh, sorry. Never mind. I was worried. It can't be 3, right? That's not in our interval. Divide by 3. 3, c squared is 3. So c is plus or minus root 3. That's better. So in 0, 3, the value of c that we want is c equals root 3. So with c equal to the square root of 3, we will in fact get f prime of c equal to the average rate of change.